Section 1 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Read by Larry Wilson. Readings and Poetry for Lent, Ash Wednesday by Sir Archibald Edmonston. Mourn ye o'er the nation's sin. Mourn his temple courts within. Priests and people, own the rod. Weeping, bow before your God. Queen of waters, veil thy pride. Boast not of thy commerce wide, that the sun doth never set on thy jeweled coronet. Boast not that thine ensigns tower. Boast not that thy foemen cower. Mourn and weep that thou canst bring to pure incense to thy king. All thy treasured gold is dross, all thy store is empty loss. Mammon reigns where God should dwell, as fiends haunt the hermit's cell. Church, our mother, fast and pray, if thou judgment may delay. Princes, priests, and people all, low before his footstool fall. Lenten time will soon pass by, catch the moments as they fly. Fasting, praying, draw ye near. He is present, he will hear. End of section 1.
Section 2 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Readings and Poetry for Lent. Reading for the first Sunday of Lent. Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and sitteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, and saith unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Jesus said unto him, It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Again the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them, and saith unto him, All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then saith Jesus unto him, Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. Those who, in obedience to the rules of their church, have resolved to make Lent a season of retirement and of spiritual improvement, a season when they will especially endeavor to mortify the lusts of the flesh and advance in their spiritual course, will find that they have entered upon a difficult work. They have voluntarily engaged to be, in an especial manner, during this period, the Lord's soldiers, and to fight against sin, the world, and the devil. And Satan, who is ever on the lookout, will take care their promise shall not be an idle one. He will give them plenty to do. Just at first it seems an easy thing to perform the pledge which we have taken. We have made a solemn resolution before God that you will resist your besetting sin, whatever it may be, and you are thinking that you will not once give way to it during the next 6 weeks, and are already imagining how pleasant it will be at Easter to look back upon your victory. But depend upon it, your task will not be thus lightly accomplished. Your great enemy will not be thus defeated. He will try by every means in his power to make you fall, and wonderful will it be if he does not succeed. If he cannot manage it one way, he will try another, and will tempt you by means which you have never thought of, and against which, therefore, you have never guarded. But be not discouraged, and above all, never think of giving up the contest. He would be a poor soldier who retreated because the enemy attacked him, and a feeble runner who gave up because his course was not all smooth. Ever remember that it is not in your own strength that the warfare is to be carried out. Though your Savior may seem to abandon you, it is only in order to try your faith. He is really beholding you with eyes of love, ready, even if you sin, to be your advocate and to strengthen you in your next struggle. He has promised that if you resist the devil, he will flee from you, and his promises are yea and amen. They cannot fail. Go on calmly from day to day, asking his assistance every morning and every evening, examining how far you have succeeded in confessing your sins to him, who is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, and you will find that the season of Lent will not have been passed in vain. Remember, too, when the devil assaults you, he is only acting to you as he did to your Lord and Master. In the verses we have just read, which have been chosen as the gospel for today, we find that our Lord, before entering upon his ministry, sought a season of retirement in which to prepare himself for his duties by prayer and fasting. And when the devil tempted him by the lusts of the flesh, by pride and by ambition, every time our Savior drove him away, not by any supernatural means, as he might have done, but by those which are open to us all. He caused him to flee by quoting Holy Scripture. The Word of God is compared by St. Paul to a sword, and our Savior, in this conflict with the evil one, set us an example of the way in which we are to fight with it. When the devil tempts us to despair, to think that we are making no progress, and shall never be any better than we are, we must fight him with some such texts as, "My grace is sufficient for thee," or "I can do all things through Christ which strengtheneth me," when he would make us think it hard to be watchful and self-denying, we must fall back upon St. John's experience. God's commandments are not grievous. When he would make us think we have been trying long enough and may now have a little rest, we must say, "Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not." And when he makes a grand effort, brings against us all his forces, and seems resolved to throw us down, let us take our Lord's own method, and in humble dependence on him, boldly say, "Get thee hence, Satan. It is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." And, "I am resolved to serve and worship him alone." End of section 2.
Section 3 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Read by Daisy Diary, Readings and Poetry for Lent. Lent by George Herbert. Welcome, dear Feast of Lent, who loves not thee. He loves not temperance or authority, but is composed of passion. The Scriptures bid us fast. The Church says now, "Give to thy mother what thou wouldst allow to every corporation." The humble soul, composed of love and fear, begins at home and lays the burden there, when doctrines disagree. He says, "In things which use hath justly God, I am a scandal to the Church, and not the Church is so to me." True Christians should be glad of an occasion to use their temperance, seeking no evasion when good is seasonable. Unless authority, which should increase the obligation in us, make it less and power itself disable. Besides the cleanness of sweet abstinence, quick thoughts and motions at a small expense, a face not fearing light, perhaps in fullness there are sluttish fumes, self-exhalations, and dishonest rooms, revenging the delight. Then, those same prudent profit which the spring and Easter intimate, enlarge the thing and goodness of the deed. Neither ought other men's abuse of Lent spoil the good use lest by their argument we forfeit all our creed. This true we cannot reach Christ's 40th day, that to go part of that religious way is better than to rest. We cannot reach our Saviour's purity, yet are we bid, be holy in as He. In both let's do our best. Who goeth in the way which Christ hath gone, is much more sure to meet with Him than one that travelleth by ways. Perhaps my God, though He be far before, may turn and take me by the hand, and more may strengthen my decays. Yet, Lord, instruct us to improve our fast by starving sin and taking such repast, as may our thoughts control, that every man may revel at his door, not in his parlour, banqueting the poor and among those he sow. End of section 3.
Section 4 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Readings and Poetry for Lent. Reading for the second Sunday of Lent. 1 Thessalonians, chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. We beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as ye have received of us how ye ought to walk and to please God, so ye would abound more and more. For ye know what commandments we gave you by the Lord Jesus. The epistle for today begins with an exhortation from the Apostle Paul to his disciples at Thessalonica, for that as they had received of him how they ought to walk and to please God, so they would abound more and more. We have had during the last few weeks four epistles taken from the writings of St. Paul, so that we, like the Thessalonians, know very well the commandments he has given, for though he was before addressing the Corinthians, doubtless his instructions would be the same in one place as in the other. He would teach them both to be temperate in all things, to keep under their bodies and bring them into subjection, to suffer long and be kind, to bear all things, hope all things, and endure all things for the sake of Christ. And he would set the same example to the Thessalonians as he did to the Corinthians. But he now proceeds to tell them why it is that they are bound to obey his commandments and to follow his example. It was because he acted not in his own name and by his own authority, but only in the name of the Lord Jesus. This is a point upon which St. Paul is always most careful to insist. He always impresses upon his converts that he only wishes them to imitate him so far as he imitates Christ, and that he only desires them to submit to his authority because he has received that authority from him. Hence he beseeches and exhorts in the name of the Lord Jesus those who have received apostolical instructions from himself. The commandments which he has given them, he declares to have been given by or through the Lord Jesus, that is, under his guidance and with his authority. We may well call to mind this reference to the source of all authority, especially at this season of the year, when we are trying more than usual to follow the teaching and obey the rules of our church. That church has power to decree rites and ceremonies, as St. Paul had of old. It is true that our ministers have not the same gifts of the Spirit as St. Paul had, for we do not see them work miracles, but they are Christ's ambassadors as well as he, and we must believe this if we believe the Bible to be true. It is evident St. Paul did not think the authority of ministers was confined to the apostles, for in writing to Titus, he bids him exhort and rebuke with all authority, and to let no man despise him. And Timothy tells to command and teach, and yet, so far as we know, neither Titus nor Timothy had seen our Lord, but had received their commission from the hands of St. Paul. But he even went further, for he not only gave them power to teach, but he deputed them to transmit this power to others. For to Titus he says, "For this cause left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city, as I had appointed thee. And to Timothy, the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. Now if Timothy and Titus had this authority, why might not their successors have it too? And why may it not have continued to the present time? There is no reason against it, but if it be so, it is wrong for us to think little of our ministers and the rules of our church. Rather, let us recognize in the instructions we thus receive the instructions of our Lord and Master. In his name his ministers speak, and so long as they faithfully deliver his message, they are to be honored and obeyed. In the present case, we have abundant reason for believing that our church rules are both wise and scriptural. May we find by practical experience at the end of Lent that to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. End of section 4.
Section 5 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Lent by George Wither. Thy wondrous fasting to record, and our rebellious flesh to tame, a holy fast to thee, O Lord, we have intended in thy name. O sanctify it, we thee pray, that we may thereby honor thee, and so dispose us that it may to our advantage also be. Let us not grudgingly abstain, nor secretly the glutton play, nor openly for glory vain thy church's ordinance obey. But let us fast as thou hast taught, thy rule observing in each part, with such intentions as we ought, and with true singleness of heart. So thou shalt our devotions bless, and make this holy discipline a means that longing to suppress, which keeps our will so cross to thine. And though our strictest fastings fail to purchase of themselves thy grace, yet they to make for our avail by thy deservings shall have blaze. True fasting helpful oft hath been, the wanton flesh to mortify, but takes not off the guilt of sin, nor can we merit aught thereby. It is thine abstinence or none, which merit favor for us must, for when our glorious works are done, we perish if in them we trust. End of section 5.
Section 6 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Readings and Poetry for Lent. Reading for the third Sunday of Lent. Ephesians 5:1-14. Be ye therefore followers of God, as dear children, and walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. But fornication and all uncleanness, or covetousness, let it not be once named among you, as becometh saints, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them, for ye were sometimes darkness, but now ye are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doth make manifest is light. Wherefore he saith, Awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. It is very beautiful to notice in what a tender manner our church addresses her children during the season of Lent. It seems as if those who arranged her services had constantly borne in mind the hard work in which we are now engaged, as if they had always remembered how difficult a thing it is to practice self-denial, and to repent of and turn from our sins, and had wished to cheer us on our road by selecting those portions of Scripture in which St. Paul speaks most gently, and in which he brings before us the most constraining motives for obedience. Quote, We then, as workers together with him, that is, Christ, beseech you that ye receive not the grace of God in vain, end quote, says he in the epistle appointed for the first Sunday in Lent. Quote, We beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, end quote, is his language in that which is read on the second Sunday, and in the one for today he is yet more tender and persuasive, for he begins by reminding us of our relationship to God and of all that our Savior has done for us. He calls us dear children, and tells us that Christ hath loved us and given himself for us. And after pointing out some of the ways in which we can show our gratitude to him, he reminds us of what we once were, and of what through God's mercy we are now become. Ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord, and bids us walk as children of light. Now, although these words were written to the Ephesians many centuries ago, they are just as applicable to us now as they were to believers then. For if Christ had not come to give us light, we should still have been in the condition of the people of Ephesus when they cried, Great is Diana of the Ephesians, or as those of our own land when they fell down and worshipped the mistletoe. And therefore we with them are equally bound to show our gratitude and love. Love is to be shown by obedience to God's commands, as we may see by the very title by which we are addressed, that of Dear Children. For how do affectionate children show their love to an earthly parent? Not chiefly or generally by talking about it and pouring forth protestations of attachment, but by striving to fulfill his slightest wishes and endeavoring to please him in all their actions. And so must we behave towards our Heavenly Father. It matters little that we call him Lord, Lord, unless we do the things which he says. If our hearts are really filled with gratitude to our Savior for having given himself as an offering for us, we shall strive to show that gratitude by giving or imitating him not only in great things, but in the everyday duties of life. We shall strive to walk in love, that is, to be loving and kind and gentle to all who are around us. And we shall rejoice to think that although it may not be in our power to do any great deed, yet for Christ's sake our smallest services are accepted. A wise father does not expect the same tasks from each of his children, but gives to each their portion according to their age and ability. And so does God deal with us. He has appointed our lot in life, has given us each duties to perform, which we cannot properly delegate to another. And it is in the performance of those duties, be they great or small, that we are to be followers of him. It is not the greatness of the service, but the spirit which actuates it, to which he looks, and which he will reward. The child who cheerfully gives up a holiday because his parents wish him to remain at home is a follower of Christ, for he went down with his parents to Nazareth, and was subject unto them. The servant who refrains from a saucy answer is a follower of him, for when he was reviled, he reviled not again. Those who strive to comfort others are followers of him, for he wept over the grave of Lazarus. Those who willingly perform little offices of kindness are followers of him, for he washed his disciples' feet. And all these things are, as the epistle tells us, fruits of the Spirit, and as such, acceptable unto the Lord. End of section 6.
Section 7 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Readings and Poetry for Lent. To Keep a True Lent by Robert Herrick. Is this a fast to keep, the larder lean and clean from fat of teals and sheep? Is it to quit the dish of flesh, yet still to fill the platter high with fish? Is it to fast an hour, or rage to go, or show a downcast look and sour? No, 'tis a fast to dole thy sheaf of wheat and meat unto the hungry soul. It is to fast from strife, from old debate and hate, to circumcise thy life, to show a heart grief rent, to starve thy sin, not bin, and that's to keep thy Lent. End of section 7. Read by Alan Mapstone.
Section 8 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Readings and Poetry for Lent. Reading for the fourth Sunday of Lent. Read the 45th chapter of Genesis, being the first lesson to be read at the evening service on the fourth Sunday in Lent. This chapter is one that at once comes home to every heart. It is scarcely possible for the most careless and hardened to listen to it with indifference. Little children will ask to be told it again and again, and gray-haired men will be moved to tears by the recollection of it. The language, though simple, is so forcible that we can almost fancy we see the scene. Behold Joseph comforting his brethren, and hear him telling them not to be grieved or angry with themselves. But if we begin to examine why it is that we are so interested, we shall see it is because of the beautiful spirit of forgiveness he displays, and shall find that in this, as in all his previous history, he was unconsciously serving as a type of the coming Savior. After having once convinced himself, in the way we considered yesterday, that the repentance of his brothers was sincere, Joseph no longer appears to have felt the slightest anger towards them. One single harsh word, one taunting expression, would have marred the beauty of the whole, but none such is uttered. He begs them not to blame themselves, shows them how their evil deeds have been overruled for good, offers them a home in his country, and sends them to fetch their father, giving them provision for the way. Not one reproach does he utter, not one does he allude to in the hardships he had endured at Potiphar's house, or his sufferings in the prison. All his thoughts seem to have been how best he could assure his brothers of his forgiveness, and prove his love towards them. Now how beautifully does all this prefigure our Savior's conduct to guilty men? If we are enabled, through God's grace, really to use Lent as a season of examination and of repentance, the sins we discover are enough to drive us to despair. Day by day they rise up against us, and the more we strive against them, the more completely they often seem to have us in their power. And if we realize in any degree that for these sins our Savior suffered, they appear so black and so heinous that we are ready to doubt whether we have any hope of obtaining God's mercy. But let us turn to the concluding passages of our Savior's life and see whether, like Joseph's brethren, we cannot obtain comfort. How did he answer the thief on the cross? He promised him a share of his kingdom. Today shalt thou be with me in paradise. How did he excuse his murderers? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Why did he say he was about to suffer? That the scriptures might be fulfilled, that thus it must be. How did he console his sorrowing, though weak disciples? Let not your heart be troubled. I go to prepare a place for you. In all these, and many, many more instances, our Lord showed himself as loving and as forgiving to us as Joseph did to his brethren. And now he is exalted on his throne of glory. It is far more impossible for him to change than it was for Joseph when he was made governor of Egypt, instead of being a younger son in his father's house. He offers us to be near unto him and to dwell with him, as Joseph wanted his brothers to live in Goshen. In my father's house are many mansions. He tells us not to regard our stuff, for the good of all that land is ours. Lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. He sends us his Holy Spirit as an earnest of the coming possession, as Joseph sent a present to his father. And though, like old Jacob, we may at times be tempted to disbelieve it, if, like him, we can remember that our Savior lives, it will give us strength to go on our way rejoicing, and to care little for the perils of the road, if at last we can behold his face. End of section 8.
Section 9 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Readings and Poetry for Lent, Hymn to God the Father, by John Donne. Wilt thou forgive that sin where I begun, which was my sin, though it were done before? Wilt thou forgive that sin through which I run, and do run still, though still I do deplore? When thou hast done, thou hast not done, for I have more. Wilt thou forgive that sin which I have won others to sin, and made my sin their door? Wilt thou forgive that sin which I did shun a year or two, but wallowed in a score? When thou hast done, thou hast not done, for I have more. I have a sin of fear, that when I have spun my last thread, I shall perish on the shore. But swear by thyself that at my death, thy sun shall shine as he shines now and heretofore. And having done that, thou hast done. I fear no more. End of section 9. Read by Alan Mapstone.
Section 10 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Read by Paula Messina. Readings and Poetry for Lent. Reading for the fifth Sunday of Lent. Hebrews chapter 9, verses 11 through 15. Being the epistle for the day. Christ being come as high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and of goats, and the ashes of an heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And for this cause, He is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the First Testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. In the epistle for today, St. Paul is speaking of the two covenants and is endeavoring to show to the Jews who lived in the time of Christ how superior was their condition to that of their brethren under the first. He admits that these had indeed a shadow of good things to come, that they had ordinances and services and sacrifices. But still, how inferior was all this to the perfect covenant under which they now were. And then he puts this striking question. If the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? In other words, if God was willing to accept the offering of the blood of bulls and of goats, will he not much more pardon those for whom was shed the blood of his dear Son? Reader, this argument of St. Paul's applies to us as well as to the Jews, and it is one on which, at this season especially, we should love to dwell. We are trying during Lent to discover our faults and by God's help to overcome them. And if we are in earnest in our work, every day will show us more and more of the wickedness of our own hearts, of our own weakness, and of our need of a Savior. We shall find out how very difficult it is for us to get rid of even a little fault, how it seems to stick to us and persecute us again and again. And when our attention is thus drawn towards it, we discover that it is one in which we have indulged for years, almost unknowingly. And yet all these transgressions have been marked by God, and if not before blotted out of his book, will appear against us at the judgment day. For instance, we were warned when Lent began that the sin of exaggeration or of prevarication was one against which we ought to guard. At first, we scarcely believed we could be guilty of it, but when we began to watch, we found ourselves constantly saying a little less or a little more than the strict truth. And when we remember how long we must have indulged in this habit, and how hateful it is in his sight who declareth that he will in no wise admit into his kingdom any one who loveth or maketh a lie, we are filled with horror, and almost think it impossible to obtain pardon. Or we have perhaps made a resolution against hastiness of temper, and have determined never once during Lent to speak angrily, unkindly, or peevishly. But unforeseen provocations have arisen, and instead of being able to say we have never failed, we can scarcely look back upon a single day in which we have entirely succeeded. Or our vow may have been against scandal. And yet how often have we caught ourselves laughing at an ill-natured tale, and even repeating it for the amusement of others? All this is very sad, and shows how impossible it would have been for us to gain heaven under the covenant of works. But it need not drive us to despair. By the Jewish law, the blood of a sheep or ox sanctified to the purifying of the flesh. But we have a better and higher sacrifice offered for us. We have not to seek it for ourselves, or to find a priest to offer it, for it has been offered once for all, and we cannot doubt its efficacy. The Jews might well say, it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. We cannot but believe that the blood of Christ, God's only Son, can purge our conscience from dead works. But how may that blood be applied to ourselves? How did the Jews use their sacrifices? When they had broken any of God's laws, they were required, first, to make restitution so far as was in their power. Then they brought their sacrifice to the priest. laid their hands upon its head. The priest slew it, and sprinkled them with its blood. And whilst he was doing this, they would doubtless remember the great sacrifice which had been promised, and would long for it to come, but would recollect that in the meantime God had promised to forgive them upon the offering up of a sacrifice, and they would humbly hope that their sins were pardoned, and would go away cheered and comforted. Just so must we act when we have sinned against God. We must first earnestly repent of our sins, and show that our repentance is sincere by making all the amends we can. Then we must confess our transgressions to our Heavenly Father, and beg Him to forgive us for the sake of His dear Son. And then we must try to grasp the thought that, for those very sins, Jesus Christ was offered. And think how great those sins must have been to require such a sacrifice. That sacrifice has been offered as surely as the goat was offered on the Day of Atonement. And if the Israelites were forgiven, shall not we also be forgiven? For if the blood of bulls and of goats, and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean, sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. End of section 10.
Section 11 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Read by Larry Wilson. Readings and Poetry for Lent. The Poor Wayfarer by James Montgomery. A poor wayfaring man of grief hath often crossed me on my way, who sued so humbly for relief that I could never answer nay. I had not power to ask his name, whither he went or whence he came. Yet there was something in his eye that won my love, I knew not why. Once, when my scanty meal was spread, he entered. Not a word he spake, just perishing for want of bread. I gave him all. He blessed it, brake, and ate, and gave me part again. Mine was the angel's portion then. For while I fed with eager haste, that crust was manna to my taste. I spied him where a fountain burst clear from the rock. His strength was gone. The heedless water mocked his thirst. He heard it, saw it hurrying on. I ran to raise the sufferer up. Thrice from the stream he drained my cup, dipped and returned it running o'er. I drank, and never thirsted more. 'Twas night. The floods were out. It blew a winter hurricane aloof. I heard a voice abroad and flew to bid him welcome to my roof. I warmed, I clothed, I cheered my guest, laid him on my own couch to rest, then made the hearth my bed, and seemed in Eden's garden while I dreamed. Stripped, wounded, beaten, nigh to death, I found him by the highway side. I roused his pulse, brought back his breath, revived his spirit, and supplied wine, oil, refreshment. He was healed. I had myself a wound concealed, but from that hour forgot the smart, and peace bound up my broken heart. In prison I saw him next, condemned to meet a traitor's death at morn. The tide of lying tongues I stemmed, and honored him midst a shame and scorn. My friendship's utmost zeal to try, he asked if I for him would die. The flesh was weak, my blood ran chill, but the free spirit cried, I will. Then in a moment to my view the stranger darted from disguise. The tokens in his hand I knew. My Savior stood before mine eyes. He spake, and my poor name he named. Of me thou hast not been ashamed. These deeds shall thy memorial be. Fear not, thou didst them unto me. End of section 11.
Section 12 of Readings and Poetry for Lent. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Readings and Poetry for Lent. Reading for the Sunday before Easter. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, being the epistle for Palm Sunday. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We are now entering the most solemn week in all the year. For what is the subject which is about to engage our attention? Is it not what angels desire to look into? Is it not the contemplation of that event which filled heaven and earth with wonder, and the remembrance of which will form the employment of another world? And yet, poor, sinful creatures such as we are permitted year after year to meditate upon it. Year after year, as the Holy Week comes round, we are told the astonishing history of our Redeemer's sufferings. And with many of us, what is the result? We listen to them as to an oft-told tale, and go away to our business or our pleasures, and live, and act, and think, as if Christ had never died, and there was no heaven, no hell, no eternity, and nothing but this perishing world to think of or care for. True, we call ourselves Christians and say heartily, we believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. And we know and believe that without him we must have perished. But there the matter ends. We do not carry the influence of our belief into the little events of everyday life. We do not leave a thing undone simply because we know it will be displeasing to our Savior, nor make an exertion because it is what he would approve. And we do not gain support under trial by thinking of him, nor get over little troubles by remembering how much worse he had to endure. In short, our faith wants reality. If we had really stood by the cross of Christ and seen his sufferings, if we had heard his feeble cry, "I thirst," if we had marked the drops of blood oozing from his brow and listened to his agonized call for help, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And if we had known, as we know now, all this was born for us this agony was endured, for us this blood was shed, could we have gone away unmoved? Would not the recollection of that scene have been ever present with us, and the remembrance of those mournful looks, of those sorrowful words have arrested us when we were about to do wrong. We cannot in body stand by the cross of Christ, for his wondrous purpose was long since accomplished, and he has returned to his heavenly home, but we may do something like it in spirit, and it is to enable us to do it that our church has appointed this annual commemoration of his sufferings. She knows how faint and how weak our faith is, and therefore, not content with telling us of the Lamb of God in all her services through Advent, Christmas, and Trinity, she sets apart one portion of the year for a special remembrance of him. Let us strive to use it as she intends. If we have followed her teaching, we have now been for some weeks occupied in thinking of our faults, in making good resolutions, and proving our weakness and inability to keep them. And now that Holy Week is come, all this should lead us to Christ. Let us try to remember that our sins, those very sins we have so lately deplored, caused him to suffer, that for us he died, and that he rose for our justification, and now lives to give us the pardon we so much require. If we have an opportunity this week of attending the daily services of our church, of course we ought thankfully to avail ourselves of it. But if we are unable to do so, still her admirable arrangements need not be in vain. We can read the collects, epistles, lessons, and especially the Gospels over to ourselves and try day by day to realize the scenes which they portray. Let us follow our blessed Redeemer through this dreadful week, see him in the upper chamber, in the garden, and in the judgment hall, and try to picture the places and people which surround him. And whilst we mark his meekness, his humility, and his love, his consideration for others and forgetfulness of self, let us pray in the words of the collect for today, that we may be enabled to follow the example of his patience, and do as the epistle teaches, have the same mind in us which was also in Christ Jesus. End of section 12. End of Lenten readings and poetry.